Yes, good morning all. I hope I am audible and the screen is also visible to all. So I welcome you all for this today's lecture. We will be planning to conduct four lectures in fact on various topics of our syllabus of engineering physics. So out of these four, two will be conducted by me. One is on superconductivity, that is today. One more will be there on nanomaterials and nanotechnology, that will be on next Friday. And there onwards we will have two more, one from Ghodke sir and one from Rushi madam. Okay, so our today's this lecture is on superconductivity. So how superconductivity was discovered, what is superconductivity, and how this subject has grown, and it has challenged the theories existing, and what are the applications, and how the existing theories are modified. All these things we are going to discuss in today's lecture. Okay, so we will wait for another minute and then we will start. Okay, so as if as on moment I could see that there are 17 of us are watching this live lecture. So let us wait for a minute and then we will proceed. So as we wish to complete the syllabus in a meaningful way and effectively, what we have decided is ki some of the content we will be conducting for all the three divisions of our college. That is division D, E and F all together on the YouTube platform. So therefore we are doing this. If at all whenever you have some doubt, you can put in the today's this chat box also, or otherwise you can mail it to me, or you can send it to through WhatsApp also. Okay, and in the next lecture we will try to discuss it. If anything you find difficult, that we will be discussing in the next lecture. Okay, I will compile all those difficulties and we will discuss it in the next lecture. Okay, so now I think we should start. So let us start the discussion about this topic, that is superconductivity. So the agenda of the lecture would be what it is, how it is, and where to use. Okay, so these questions are not only related to the superconductivity kind of a thing, but it is perhaps the working logic of engineers ki to understand, to know what something is, and then understand and apply it in some situations, and to get some useful things out of that thing. Okay, so let us start it with one or two slides. So that is of course to be comfortable with the subject content. So what this slide is saying is ki physics would have been much easier if tree had fallen on Newton's head instead of the apple. So apple fall on the Newton's head and he discovered gravity, and the all the complicated mechanics and these things are there only because of the this event perhaps is the starting point of all these things. So somebody is mischievously thinking instead of this apple, the complete tree would have fallen the Newton's head. Unfortunate event that would be, but in a comic way that is being said. Okay, so we know what this is. This is a ohm, a symbol of resistance. So what this is doing here is, so all the ohms are meditating. So we had this yoga day I think on 21st of June last month. Okay, so everybody was requested to do yoga at their home. So this yoga is this one ohm is telling to the resistance, that resistance is of course looking unhappy here. So this ohm is saying, come meditate with me, you don't have to resist everything. Okay, so resistance is of course it will resist everything. So perhaps that is the starting point of the discussion, ki having what is the origin of resistance and how does this resistance changes with temperature, and what is the modification into this resistance absence or presence with the magnetic field is the essence of superconductivity. Okay, so therefore all the ohms you can see in the background, they are meditating and they are saying, okay, so I think there was some connectivity issue, but now I hope the screen is visible and we can continue. Okay, so let us continue with this. Okay, so how does this resistance gets affected with the change in temperature? So if suppose what is the starting point of this would be this blue dots here. These are, let us say, these are the ions. Okay, in the material, in the metal, in the crystal, these are the ions, and this is the electron. So when we try to allow this electron to flow through this lattice, so what will happen? This electron will suffer collisions here, attraction and scattering, and then it will be moving in a random path, and it would take more energy, and it will be ultimately going from one end to other end. Okay, so if that is if we have higher temperature, so these ions would be vibrating vigorously, and that will lead to the thermal agitation, and this thermal agitation will lead to higher amplitude of the scattering, and that will ultimately result into resistance. So we know this for the metals, normal metals, they are good conductors, but as we increase the temperature, so with the increase in temperature, what happens is the resistance of the substance goes on increasing. Okay, so in metals we know, as we will increase the temperature, the resistance will increase. And how does that that affects the flow of electrons, that I am going to show you here. Let us see. Okay, so let me go here. I hope this will be visible. Okay, so for a minute I will wait. Yes, so what we can see on the screen is these are the two 1.5 volt batteries are connected in series. So the total voltage is given is 3 volts, and this is the wire, this is the wire of iron that is connected, and here is it is wound over this ceramic material, and it is connected to the negative terminal. So this is what you can see. And now you can see here the burner, there is a burner placed here, and this burner is not having flame, and it is of course connected to a gas supply. Okay, so now if I you can see this bulb is glowing here. If I turn on this, so you can see this is now, there is a flame and it is burning, and because of this the resistance in the circuit has increased and flow of the electrons has reduced, and therefore this bulb goes off. So if I switch off this burner again, so you can see the intensity of the bulb is increasing, and now it is glowing to the full intensity. Okay, so if I turn it off again, so what will happen, turn it on again, then it will be burning. Due to this heat, the resistance has increased, and therefore the flow of electrons is reduced, and therefore there is no enough current flowing through this bulb to make it glow. Okay, so this is the primary discussion that I wanted to create some kind of background about this. So with that we will go back to this thing. So what we are trying to understand is normally in what in the higher temperature what happens to the metals. Okay, so with this now we will this is of course the images collected. If at all it doesn't work in the streaming, so what I did is I put the images into presentation also. So with the help of these images we can again understand this thing ki if the flame is not there then the resistance is less and bulb is glowing. If the flame is there, resistance is higher and therefore the bulb is not glowing. Okay, so this is the case about the higher temperature side. But what about the lower temperature side? So in the lower temperature side this experiment was conducted. So what was the motive is how does the metals they behave at the low temperature. So as you can see here there is a this is the graph that the temperature is increasing in this direction and the resistance is plotted here. Okay, so for mercury you can see here it is Hg mercury. So what was expected is ki this resistance there would be always some resistance present and it will be something like this. Okay, so at zero temperature, zero of the temperature, still there would be at the zero of the temperature there would still be some resistance present in the metals. Okay, but with the mercury when this experiment was conducted, so at around 4.2 Kelvin, 4.15 Kelvin exactly, so at this temperature what happened is resistance suddenly dropped and you can see this dotted line here and the resistance of the substance was zero. So what do we mean by this is how do we define superconductivity? The loss of electrical resistance at very low temperature is superconductivity. Okay, so resistance falls to zero at low temperature and vanishing of electrical resistance, this phenomenon we call it as the superconductivity. Okay, so this is the this is the situation that was expected ki electrical resistance is on the y axis and temperature is on x axis. So what was expected is though the lattice ions vibrations would decrease with the decrease in temperature, but electrical resistance will not become zero and there would be some finite value of electrical resistance at the zero Kelvin. Okay, but what was observed experimentally was in case of the superconductor something like mercury, at certain temperature the resistance suddenly dropped to zero and that temperature at which this happened was labeled as critical temperature. So what we need to remember about this is the metals or the materials would remain in superconducting state below a certain temperature. That temperature we call it as the critical temperature. Okay, so how do we remember this? So any substance which is having zero electrical resistance, that will happen below a certain temperature, that temperature we call it as the critical temperature, and beyond that temperature or higher than that temperature the there would be this electrical resistance would be again present there and that will be in the normal state. Okay, so the critical temperature is the temperature which separates the superconducting, we can say that it is separating the superconducting state and normal state. So below critical temperature the substance would be in superconducting state and higher the temperature than the critical temperature the material will return to the superconducting state. Okay, so this is what was the starting point of this thing and this was an observation. So later on the theory about this and the answers why this is like this that was given, so that we are going to discuss in the discussion. So what we need to remember, vanishing of electrical resistance but at very low temperature is called as superconductivity. The substance will remain in the superconducting state when the temperature is below that temperature, a specific temperature change different for different substances, and above that temperature the substance will be in normal state. So that temperature we call it as the critical temperature. Okay, so So with this, now if we look at the periodic table, so in the periodic table, how many substances are superconductors, whether they are in normal temperature, normal pressure conditions, they are superconductors, or some modifications are required, or whether it happens at a high pressure. So that can be summarized into this observation table here. Not an observation table. What it is the periodic table from where we can get this information. So you can see in bulk at ambient pressure, that is this red color. So lithium, beryllium, this titanium, vanadium, these are all in bulk form in the ambient pressure. This bunch of elements here. This bunch of elements here, few bunched here, so across the rows and columns they are there. So in the normal pressure and in the bulk form, they are superconductors. Some of them, they become superconductors at very high pressure, so they are also highlighted, and some of them are superconductors in the modified form, so they are also separately highlighted. Okay. So we can see there are nearly 70% of the periodic table, they are these elements are superconductors, but moreover, the interesting thing is their combinations and their various formulas that we generate, they are also superconductors. Okay. So let us go further into this. So what you can see in this image is this sumo wrestler, he is standing on a metal plate, and you can that portion is zoomed here. Okay, so you can see here, so there is a gap between the lower metal plate and higher metal plate, and they are not touching to each other, though this heavyweight sumo wrestler is standing. So literally the air can blow through it, and it is floating in the air. Okay, so keep this thing in your mind, something like this you observed, and we will be discussing this thing into the coming slides. So what you can see here is there is a base made, and on the base there is a pair of metal plates, and the sumo player, he is his weight is 142 kgs, and he is standing on the top side metal plate, and still there is air gap between the two metal plates. So what this is, that I will tell you. Okay, so the temperature that separates the superconducting state and normal state, that state we call it as the critical temperature. Okay, so one more observation is there about the superconductors, that when the substance is in the superconducting state, and if you are instead of doing variations in the temperature, if we start applying the magnetic field to the superconductors, so what was observed is if we consider that this circle here is a superconductor, and we try to apply magnetic field starting from a weak strength, and we keep on increasing the strength, so what will happen is this magnetic field will not be allowed to pass through the substance, and it will be expelled from the superconductor. Okay, so this was one of the observation, that the superconductors in superconducting state, they behave as the perfect diamagnetic substance. So what I am telling you is a superconductor in superconducting state. So what do we mean by that? Superconductor in superconducting state. So if you see here, this is the situation where the temperature is greater than critical temperature. So the substance is not in the superconducting state. Here you can see temperature is greater than critical temperature. That means this substance here, it is not in superconducting state, and if we apply magnetic field, it is allowed to pass through it. So it is the magnetic field of lines are passing through it. Okay, but when we reduce the temperature, that is the temperature is made lesser than the critical temperature, the temperature around the substance is less than the critical temperature of the substance, then what has happened is the magnetic field of lines are expelled out of it. So the magnetic field of lines are no more able to pass through the substance, and they are bending from at the surface, and they are not penetrating through the substance. Okay, so what we need to remember is superconductors. They are showing the perfect diamagnetism, that they are not allowing the magnetic field of lines to pass through them. Okay, so what will happen if we keep increasing the magnetic field strength? If the temperature is lesser than critical temperature and still we keep on increasing the magnetic field strength, then at certain magnetic field strength, though the temperature is below critical temperature, the superconducting state will be destroyed and material will return to the normal state. Okay, so to keep something in superconducting state, what do you need? You need the temperature to be less than critical temperature, and if at all there is a magnetic field present, that magnetic field must be less than a critical magnetic field. Okay, so what we have collected in last 20-25 minutes is absence of any kind of electrical resistance is superconductivity, that occurs in the substances below a certain temperature. That temperature we call it as the critical temperature. If we have a superconductor and the temperature is greater than critical temperature, and then we apply magnetic field on it, the magnetic field of lines passes through it. But if we reduce the temperature and the temperature goes below critical temperature, then magnetic field lines would be expelled from the substance, and that effect we call it as the Meissner effect. And that is what somebody suppose asks us, what is Meissner effect? So what do we need to tell as the answer to this question is, the expulsion of magnetic field of lines from a superconductor when it is in the superconducting state, and this behavior of superconductors being perfectly diamagnetic is called as Meissner effect. Okay, so this is the logic of this. This is the information that we need to have about the Meissner effect. Okay, so you can see this magnetic field is inside the superconductor is zero, so B is equal to zero. Of course, the magnetic field of lines would penetrate through the surface, and there would be a competition. There would be a counter between the internal force from the superconductor and the external magnetic field, and the external magnetic field would penetrate through certain length. That length is labeled as lambda, and we call it as the penetration depth. So when you have enough strength, this penetration depth would be throughout the substance, and the substance would return into the normal state. Okay, so when we put a superconductor in a magnetic field, an electric current flows through its surface. These currents create a magnetic field. Okay, so that magnetic field cancels the original field trying to get inside the superconductor, and repel the magnetic field, the outside magnetic field. So this is known as Meissner effect, and this is the reason that I showed you that image where that sumo wrestler was standing on the metal plate, and the metal plate on which the sumo wrestler was standing, that was hanging in the air. Why? Because the lower substance was a superconductor in superconducting state, and the upper surface on which the sumo wrestler is standing, that is also a magnet. So that magnet is not allowed to pass its magnetic field of lines through this lower superconducting surface, and therefore it is hanging in the air. Okay, so now we understand how the sumo wrestler was able to stand on that floor, which was levitating and which was hanging in the air. So why? Because the lower surface is in the magnetic state, and the surface on which the sumo wrestler is standing, he is standing on a magnetic plate. Okay, so This is how, if we wish to do it in the instead of this sumo wrestler and something like that, if we wish to do some experiment in the laboratory, so what we can do is, you can see here, this is a superconductor here, and what we have done is, we have this container here, okay, so heat insulating container, and what we have done is, we have poured this liquid nitrogen around the superconductor. So here we have this liquid nitrogen here, and because of this liquid nitrogen, the temperature is reduced, and the temperature is reduced to an extent where the superconductor's critical temperature is achieved, and lesser than critical temperature. So yahan par around it we have a temperature which is lesser than the critical temperature of this superconductor. So therefore, what has happened is, this magnet is levitating on it, and it is hanging in the you can see it is as if it is hanging in the air. Okay, so this phenomenon we call it as the Meissner effect. Okay, so with the discovery of this, how many Nobel prizes are being fetched into this this field of superconductivity? So the Nobel prizes awarded in the physics for various achievements in the superconductivity. So in 1913, the scientist who discovered this phenomenon is Hague Kamerlingh Ohms, and he discovered the phenomenon and he got the Nobel Prize in 1913. Okay, so after that, the theory that explains the behavior, why it is like that, that was explained by three scientists, John Bardeen, Leon Cooper, and John Schrieffer. That occurred in 1972. And that was called as the BCS theory, explaining various observations about the superconductivity. So what are the observations? Two observations you know. One is, the material turns into a superconductor without any resistance, the electrons flow, there would be a current flowing, and that will remain present if at all you remove the power supply. This is one thing. And if we apply a magnetic field to it, then the magnetic field strength would be, if it is high enough, then it would destroy the superconducting state. So there are other observations. So all these observations, there was a reason, there was a theory proposed for this, and that theory was accepted. So that theory, this fetched Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer a Nobel Prize in 1972. So immediately after 1972, the Leo Isaki, Gevier, and Josephson, that effect, now we call it as the Josephson effect. So it is the tunneling phenomenon of the electrons. So you can see there is an image that I have shown at the center here. So here it is. Okay. So it is the road or tunnel made. So if we have two superconductors separated by a thin insulating layer, so electrons will go from one side to other side. They will penetrate, they will tunnel through the insulating layer. So that effect was discovered in 1973. So that effect is called as Josephson effect. Okay. So in 1987, one more development happened into this field of superconductivity, because all the transition temperatures for the metals and for their some alloys and some compounds for the various compositions, what was the temperature that was achieved is very low temperature. So there was no improvement, 4 Kelvin, 6 Kelvin, 1.2 Kelvin, some like 10 Kelvin, that was the range of temperature. So very low temperatures. But in 1987, Johnson Bendrose and Karl Müller, they came up with this high temperature superconductors. So suddenly this transition temperature, it shifted from somewhere around 10 Kelvin to 80 Kelvin, 90 Kelvin. So still it is very low temperature, because 80 Kelvin, 90 Kelvin, that temperature, that temperature, it mounts to what we call it as around minus 150 Kelvin, 150 degree Celsius. Okay, so that temperature would be still very low temperature, but as compared to this 4 Kelvin, 10 Kelvin, it was quite higher. So that discovery of high temperature superconductors that has fetched the Nobel Prize in 1987. Okay, in the recent developments in 2003, so Alexei Abrishkov, this Ginsburg and Liggett, they found this type 2 superconductors, and their explanation of superfluidity that was given in 2003. So they fetched a Nobel Prize for that thing. Okay, so this is the timeline or the developments in the field of superconductivity. Okay, so we can see this image here, that is Hake Ohms. He is with this instrument that he used for the demonstration of superconductivity, and he got this Nobel Prize for the investigations on the properties of matter at low temperature, which led inter alia to the production of liquid helium. So this discovery is one thing is there, that is about the superconductivity, but the one more important thing that is related to this is how to get helium liquefaction of helium. That is also one of the prominent thing, and that happened at of course at very low temperature. So this is the history of this thing. Okay, so these are the three people, that is John Bardeen, Leon Cooper and Robert Schrieffer. So what was their contribution is they proposed this, that electrons, they do not flow alone. So what they will do is they will be in the bound state. So there would be a pair of electrons, and these electrons, the pair of electrons, they will be having equal and opposite spin and momentum. So these two electrons, they will remain in a bound state at a very low temperature, and there would be an attractive interaction between two electrons. So normally we know because of this Coulomb force, the electrons would repel each other, but at a very low temperature there would be an attractive interaction between two electrons by means of a phonon exchange dominates the repulsive Coulomb interaction. So this Coulomb force would be dominated by this attractive interaction with the help of these phonons, and that leads to the superconducting state. Okay, so why I have done this thing, that I have shown two these Nobel medals with the Bardeen, is he is the scientist who is responsible, and he was involved into the other important thing, that is the transistor. So discovery of transistor and the developments of the first transistor, so he got a Nobel Prize for that thing also. So Bardeen was involved in developing the BCS theory, as well as he was responsible for the transistor's discovery, or the inventing this thing that we can put the three semiconducting layers around in a specific way, and you can get the amplification activity. Okay, so therefore he has two Nobel Prizes on his credit. Okay, so the main points of the BCS theory was there were a few important facts about this BCS theory, that is an attractive electron-electron interaction mediated by the phonons gives rise to this Cooper pairs, and bound state is formed, and these two electrons, instead of being so there is a category of these fundamental particles. So one of the classification is the classification is, there are some of them, they are the fermions, and there are some of them, they are bosons. So these photons can be categorized in the form of bosons, and the electrons are the fermions. So at the very low temperature, these electrons, they start behaving like bosons in a pair, in a group of two, and that happens to be the lowest energy state for them, and they move through the lattice without any scattering, and this movement of the electrons without any scattering, that leads to the current, and therefore we have this superconductivity at very low temperature. And as the temperature rises, what will happen is the electrons will not remain in the bound state, and therefore the superconductivity would be lost. Okay, and one more observation was made about how does the isotopes change the behavior of superconductivity. So this if there is what we mean by isotope is they are having the same place in the periodic table and they have same chemical properties but different physical properties. If there is some proportion of it, something like this, there are two mercury isotopes, let us say one is having atomic mass 200.6 and the other one is having 198. So their transition temperature for 200 it is 4.156 and for mercury 198 it is 4.177. okay, so as the atomic mass has increased, what has happened is the critical temperature is decreased. So this is one of the observation about the isotopes in the superconductivity. Okay, so let us try to understand this Cooper pair formation with this animation here. So what we can see is these are the ions. They are fixed into their these lattice points, and this is one electron we are having here. So this electron is moving, of course, in the superconducting state. So let us say what is happening is this electron is moving, and because of this is getting attracted by these positively charged ions. And at a very low temperature, what is happening is because the ions are not having enough energy and they are not vigorously vibrating. So this effect of attracting is prominent. So when this electron is moving through this, you can see the positive ions are close to it, and because of this, around this electron there is a positive charge present. Okay, so what next will happen is because of this positive charge around this electron here, so another electron will get attracted towards this electron. So according to this Coulomb repulsion, this electron should not get attracted with this electron, but why it is happening is because these ions are not vigorously vibrating, the temperature is low, this electron can attract the positive ions while moving through the lattice, and because of that there is a positive charge around this the earlier one electron, and the other electron which in a normal state way we can say this electron sees that there is a positive charge here which is exactly not of this electron, because of these two ions it is there, so this electron will get attracted to it, and because of that these two electrons will remain into this bound state, and these two electrons will move through the lattice without any resistance. Okay, so this bound state of the electron that will remain in the bound state till the temperature is beyond the critical temperature, or the applied field strength is beyond the critical magnetic field. Okay, so I will do it one more time. This is the electron that is approaching to these ions, and due to this very low temperature they are nearly fixed to their positions, they are not vigorously vibrating and there is no scattering. So this electron is getting this electron is attracting these ions, so due to this there would be a another electron getting attracted towards it, that creates these electrons into a bound state, and these bound state electrons they move through the lattice without any resistance, and that is lost. Okay, so that is the understanding of the that is the theory that was developed by Bardeen, Cooper and Schrieffer, and for that they got the Nobel Prize. Okay, so these electrons, you can see they are happily moving through the lattice, they are in the bound state, and the single electrons they are facing some challenges, but these Cooper pair electrons they are in the bound state and they are happily rolling and moving through this roller coaster. Okay, so when you will have this very high temperature or very high magnetic field, so they would be splitted and the normal state would be again achieved. Okay, so this the other image that I have shown is this ice skating game. So the participants, they are allowed to move through this ice floor, and they would be moving and dancing and exhibiting their these skills. So that is the लॉजिक दैट आई वॉन्टेड टू रिलेट कि एट लो टेम्परेचर दिज इलेक्ट्रॉन्स वुड रिमेन इन दी बाउंड स्टेट एंड इफ द टेम्परेचर ऑफ दिस आइस फ्लोर इज इंक्रीजिंग सो दे वुड नॉट बी एबल टू मूव विद देयर शूज नॉर्मली एंड दे विल बी अपार्ट. ओके सो द नेक्स्ट इज दिस जोसेफसन इफेक्ट. So these three people, they got this Nobel Prize for this observation in 1974. So what was that? That is the tunneling phenomenon of the Cooper pair electrons through the insulators. So I am having that image in the next slide. So if you have two superconductors and they are separated by an insulator, so these electrons and that is one of the prominent observations of the quantum mechanics that we are going to discuss in the modern physics section, that these electrons they are having finite probabilities and they would move from the one side to the other side. Okay, so this is the image that we will take help of to understand the Josephson effect. So a DC current is flowing across the junction in the absence of any electric or magnetic field. Okay, so if the DC voltage is applied across the Josephson junction, the current disappears and a high frequency radio wave would be developed. So what is the observation is you are not applied any electric field or magnetic field around the superconductors. They are in superconducting state, they are separated by a non-superconducting insulating layer, and still the electrons would be in this bound state and they would be going from one superconductor to the superconductor. And if at all we apply a DC voltage to this junction, what would happen? The current would disappear and a high frequency radio wave will be developed. Okay, so this is in fact this observation is helpful and is used in one of the prominent application. Okay, so what we have done in last 40-45 minutes is we tried to understand and define superconductivity. Then we tried to define two critical parameters, that is magnetic field and temperature, that we have done. And then we have taken a historical account of the observations with the help of the scientists' images, their apparatus that they used, and the prominent findings they had. And what after that we have done is with the help of that animation we try to understand how does Cooper pairs are formed and how does that Cooper pair electrons they keep moving through the lattice. Okay, so I hope till this moment whatever we have discussed is clear and is okay, and we are running with proper time and we are still having 15-20 minutes with us, and I hope we will be able to complete the content that we wanted to discuss. Okay, so next observation that is very interesting observation that came out of this superconductivity is, as we have this fundamental electronic charge, that is we call it as 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 is this number, and this is the smallest electronic charge that is possible, and the electronic charge would be in multiples of this 1, 2, 3. And we similarly have this Planck's constant H. So flux, that is magnetic field lines passing through a unit area, that is also quantized, and that is also having a specific amount, and that will be multiple of that amount. So that flux quantization is one of the findings that we got from the superconductors. So not only electronic charge is having a smallest repeating unit, that is the electronic charge as a quantum of electric charge, the photon is the packet of energy for light or electromagnetic radiation. So we know E is equal to that energy of that photon is E is equal to h nu. Okay, similarly magnetic field of lines will also be having a quantization, and that quantum of the magnetic field lines will be called as phi symbol, and it would be having value h upon 2e and if we put the value of Planck's constant and electronic charge, it turns out to be 2.07 into 10 to the power minus 15 Webers, or what we call it as the in if we wish to put it in terms of Tesla. So 2.07 into 10 to the power minus 15 Tesla meter square. So what we will remember here onwards is the magnetic field of lines are also quantized, and that flux is quantized into the values of 2.07 into 10 to the power minus 15. Okay, so now if we combine these two things, that flux quantization and Josephson effect, so if we put them together, so we have one device which is called as SQUID, that is superconducting quantum interface device. And what is this superconducting quantum interface device, which is in a short form it is put as the SQUID? So it is a very sensitive magnetometer. So what do we mean by magnetometer? I think we have discussed this while performing this experiment, Hall effect. Okay, so Hall effect mein what humne kya kiya tha ke we wanted to measure the magnetic field strength between the two electromagnets. So we had that probe which we held in between the two electromagnets, and because of that we can measure the magnetic field strength. Okay, so what we have done is we changed the current through the electromagnets, and therefore magnetic field strength was changing. So that was one of the device that we used as a magnetometer. Okay, and we also you might have seen in the physics laboratory we have this mirror kind of a thing on which there would be a needle pointed, and that there would be a north and south magnet would be placed, and what the magnetic field is making some angle, the magnetic field that we have produced, whether it is making some angle with the Earth's magnetic field, that is measured with that device. So that is one of the magnetometer. So if we wish to measure very small magnetic fields, that is 10 to the power minus 15 or 10 to the power minus 18 is the magnitude of the magnetic field strength, something in the present in the human brain, and some analysis with the that magnetic field is to be done. So we will be requiring a device which would be able to measure the magnetic field strength at very very sensitive and very small value. So that device we call it as the SQUID. So here onwards what we will remember is SQUID is superconducting quantum interface device. It is a magnetometer, and it is a very sensitive magnetometer, and it's it measures the magnetic fields at a very it can measure very small magnetic fields. And what will be the logic? It consists of the microscopic superconducting loop with one or two these Josephson junctions. So here onwards we know, okay, what do we mean by Josephson junction? Is the two superconductors separated by a insulator, okay, so which is not in superconducting state. Okay, so when when we cool the substance to the well below the critical temperature, the magnetic field would be trapped in a loop, and that has led to the development of this concept of flux quantization of the magnetic field lines. Okay, so with that, now we will move towards the high temperature superconductors. So this high temperature superconductor was one of the prominent developments. Why? Because is earlier we had this transition temperatures not more than 10 Kelvin somewhere. So with the discovery of this high temperature superconducting oxide materials, the superconducting temperature has now shifted to somewhere 150 Kelvin or in the range of these values. Okay, if we see, these are the some of the compounds that I put it in the form of a list. So you can see some neodymium, cerium, copper oxide is having 24 Kelvin as the transition temperature, and some of the other compounds they are having these compounds are having around 130, 140 Kelvin as the transition temperature. Okay, so then the next development that has happened in recently in 2003, that is the type 2 superconductors and the explanation of type 2 superconductors and what do we mean by superfluids. Okay, so what is that is we have two types of superconductors. One is the normal type 1 superconductors, and the other one they are called as, so this is the basic and the most we can say the funny classification we have is there are two types of superconductors. One is type 1 superconductor and the other one is type 2 superconductor. Okay, so how does what is the distinction between a type 1 and type 2 superconductor? So in type 1 superconductor, the superconductivity is lost all at once, so below the critical magnetic field the superconductivity would be present, and above the critical magnetic field the substance would turn into a normal substance. So as we keep on increasing the magnetic field, the magnetic field strength would keep increasing and suddenly it will drop to zero value. Okay, so in the type 2 superconductor the substance remains into a mixed state, that is it is having some magnetic field as well as it is having normal state as well as the superconducting state, and the complete superconductivity is lost at a very high value of HC2, that is having a very large value. So how do we what is the use of this is these substances, they have no applications as such, because this thing happen at a very low temperature and complete superconductivity is lost, whereas we have mixed superconductivity here and the required magnetic field to destroy the superconductivity is very high. So we can use this kind of superconductors into various applications, while this type 1 superconductors they are of no practical or engineering applications. Okay, so ultimate aim of this kind of a work would be having superconductivity at room temperature. Okay, so of course people are working on into that direction, that you have superconductivity at room temperature. So recently in 2020 there was a article published in Nature, that is they received this data and they published it, ki room temperature madhe superconductivity they found it. Okay, but the trick here is the pressure is very high. So this carbonaceous sulfur hydride material, this system has the superconducting transition temperature of 287 Kelvin, that is around 15 degree Celsius. 273 is the 0 degree Celsius, so 287 is around 14-15 degree Celsius, but this superconductivity they achieved at a very high pressure, that is 267 plus minus 10 gigapascals. Okay, so what you can see here is there are two diamonds, and in between two diamonds they are applying a very high pressure. So this pressure we know force upon area. So this two diamonds are there, and in between two diamonds they have crushed this compound of hydrogen, sulfur and carbon to get the superconductivity at room temperature. So this is again challenging to maintain this very high pressure, and that is possible only with this at this small scale, but we never know, with some scientific developments we will get superconductivity at room temperature at normal pressures, and that would change the situation. How do we get the power transmission and other things also. Okay, now let us try to understand a few of the applications of the superconductivity. So this superconductivity, it is used in one of the prominent application is better imaging in MRI. So we know what do we do in the this is used as the technique for the imaging in the medical field for the patient who is suffering from something. So if we wish the imaging or magnetic field to be sensed at a very small strength, we use superconductivity. If we wish very high magnetic field to be used for the scanning purpose, we use superconductivity. So either you need a very small magnetic field to be measured, you will use squid. If you wish to scan and to see the very high resolution images of the body parts with the to locate the tumors or something through MRI, you need a you can use the superconductors. Okay, so what is the prominent thing into this is if you have low resistance, you would have low heating, and but the challenge is you need stronger current, so that would be requiring, that would have a higher resistance, and that will result into still more power consumption. So what you can do is you can use you can generate strong currents, you can use strong magnets, but that at the low temperature. Okay, so that is required in MRI. So if you see some these medical setups where the scanning is done, there would be these long cylinders of liquid nitrogen would be present. So why they are there? Because they need to maintain the temperature at very low temperature, and they have superconductors in the MRI image, and they generate a very high magnetic field strength, something like 2-3 tesla, and that magnetic field strength they use for the scanning the human body. Okay, and of course this magnetic levitation train, that is a very fast train, around 450-500 kilometers per hour, that kind of speed is achieved. So what do they do is this the track is made with the some magnetic lines, and the train tires or that thing would be again of the magnetic poles, and these magnetic poles will push and hang in the air around 3-4 inches in the air, and due to this attraction between north south and this thing, there would be a thrust, and that will keep moving this this thing. So this is the one of the application of this thing, and the last or there are of course other applications. One more application is there, that is the superconductor based supercomputers. So these transitions that would require very the superconductors, they need a very high number of operations to be conducted in a very small period of time. So a normal laptop that would perform around 10^9 operations in 1 second, but these superconductors, they would be performing around 10^18 transitions, so those floating point operations per second. So if we wish to do it with the normal computers that the superconductor do in a second, that would require around this 31688, so a very large number of years to complete it, and this would require a huge power, and that would require, that will generate a lot of heat. So to overcome this, what we can use is we can use the superconductors. So to cooling down the superconductor, that would again require power, but that power consumption would be very small as compared to the power that is required without use of superconductors into this supercomputers. Okay, so that is one of the applications. So this is one of the train that was a maglev train, that is now it is kept in a exhibition. Okay, so this is in 2015, this a manned 7 car, that means there were 7 bogies to it. So the maglev train, it reached to a speed of 603 kilometers per hour, that is less than the earlier record of the this was achieved 1 week earlier, that is 590 kilometers per hour. So a very high speed these trains are possible with the help of these applications of the superconductors. Okay, so this high temperature superconductors, their images I wanted to show you. So these high temperature cuprates, they are layered structures. So you can see there are lot many layers into it. They are anisotropic. Anisotropic means the properties, they change in the direction. So if we see, this is the copper oxygen plane. So this copper oxygen plane, they are having, they allow the Cooper pairs to flow, but in this direction there is no Cooper pair flow is possible. So it remains into this insulating into this direction, but the Cooper pairs electron, they flow easily into this direction. Okay, so this is why we call them as the anisotropic materials. So these are the ceramic materials, high temperature superconductors. They are poor in ductility, so you cannot stretch it and have a wire of it. Okay, and they are brittle, and the content of oxygen is very critical for these high temperature superconductors. So two of the most prominent high temperature superconductors are yttrium barium copper oxide, and the formula is YBA2Cu3O7-delta. So some oxygen variation would be there, and the other one is Ti2Ba2CaCu2O8. So I think 5-6 elements from the periodic table are mixed. So into this. So this is some information about the high temperature superconductors that I wanted to give it to you. Okay, so with this now, what we will do is we will have some true false kind of questions based on the discussion that we did. And what you do, just try to comment being whether the question 1, 2, 3 you think it is true or false. So I will read out the question and you can just mention your response into the chat box. Okay, so electrical resistance of a substance in superconducting state becomes zero. If you think that it is true, then you can mention as 1.T in the chat box. That is, for one you think it is the response is true, and otherwise if you think it is response is this statement made is false, so you can mention it in the chat box as 1.F. That is, for one it is false. So electrical resistance of a substance in superconducting state becomes zero. Second is, in superconducting state the material becomes paramagnetic. So do we think that the substance becomes paramagnetic in superconducting state? So while the substance is in superconducting state, does it become a paramagnetic material? Third is, for achieving superconductivity, a pair of electrons interact attractively in phonon field. These electrons are termed as Cooper pair electrons. So whether this statement is true or false, that is statement number 3, for achieving superconductivity, a pair of electrons interact attractively in phonon field. These electrons are termed as Cooper pair electrons. Fourth is, Meissner effect is related to optical behavior of superconductors. So is Meissner effect is related to optical behavior of superconductors? If you think that this is correct, that the Meissner effect is related to optical behavior, mentioned as true, and otherwise you can mention as false. And the last is, the temperature at which normal material turns into a superconductor is called as critical temperature. So do we believe and do we know now that it is the temperature at which normal material turns into a superconductor is labeled as, or is called as, the critical temperature. So I hope everybody is putting their opinion about this and their information received through the lecture. So let us check. No, that checking is, I think it is missed out. Okay, so I will share it with you. If you have mentioned that electrical resistance of the superconductor in superconducting state becomes zero, so this is true. In superconducting state the material becomes paramagnetic. It is false, it becomes diamagnetic. For 3 it is true, 4th it is false again, and the 5th it is true again. So true, false, true, false, true. So that is the sequence, alternately starting from true. So if all of the 5 answers you received as the correct answers, so you have you have listened to the lecture correctly, and this will help you in the further growth in this topic and in general in our engineering career, that how a discovery that started in the 19th century that is still helping us in modern applications like quantum computing, qubits, and the other applications. Okay, so let us stop here. I thank you all for the attending this lecture through this platform also. Normally we do it in our separately in different three classes, but we merged the three classes using this YouTube platform, and we could complete this lecture in this content in one lecture. Okay, so I think Ghodke sir has shared this attendance link in the chat box, so please do feel the do attempt that quiz and ensure your attendance is marked. Okay, so let us stop here, and I stop the live streaming. If you have some doubts, you can ask afterward through WhatsApp, through calling, or we will discuss some more details in the next lecture. Okay, thank you.